Tell us then, what is the latest? Because you said you're going to do whatever you can to defend your rights legally. Just give us a bit of a flavor of how things have progressed in the last couple of months.
Well, I mean, to give you a little back of history, we have not sought legal solution to a problem. The Djiboutians started by actually taking the case to the UK courts because our agreement and concession is based on English law. That took 2 to 3 years of legal battle, which finally the court decided in our favor, and basically it have not accepted and rejected all the claims made by Djibouti. And so when that happened, I thought that the battle is over and maybe there's a misunderstanding. But then we have been, of course, approached by the government with unacceptable changes to the concession. So whatever they sought to change using the legal system have failed. They tried to take the hand in their hand, basically, the changes by changing their law and changing things, which we rejected. I think you've seen in the media that every time they try to do something to change the status quo, the court in England, which is in charge of the agreement, does go in our favor.
What we need to know and what the market needs to know is what exactly are you going to do? Are you going to go for an arbitration? Are you confident that you can do a deal with the Djibouti government? That's what the market wants to know.
Let me tell you, we are already in arbitration. We did the arbitration. So the arbitration,
are you starting a new arbitration?
No. Arbitration has decided in our favor, decided that this claim that they made is has no basis.
Yes.
And so basically this is a battle that will continue. It's going to be a long legal battle. We will pursue it with every power we have legally. The reason we're doing that is not the financial effect, which is negligible to DP World, but this is a very important thing for Africa, that African nations need to follow the international law and rules.
Yeah.
Africa needs private-public partnership, and we did. When we came to Djibouti, it's not like it was the biggest opportunity in the world. It was actually not feasible.
I mean, speaking of opportunities, given your size and scope, you have a great finger on the pulse when it comes to global trade. How are things at the moment? Because the data that we're seeing from different parts of the world shows that it is having an impact. Things are beginning to slow down. Are you seeing the same thing with your clients and with your operation?
The market is softening a little bit. We see slow growth in certain countries. I think these are reactions to the trade wars. It's a lot of it is psychological. But one thing for sure, trade is going to continue. Whatever China find it difficult to sell in the United States, they're going to be selling it somewhere else. I don't see a net reduction in trade, but you cannot really judge what's happening based on these periods that we've seen, because it's a reaction threat to the United States. A lot of people, financial analysts, will try to explain that in a negative way.
Can I ask you, as you look at the global stage at the moment, who has the upper hand in this trade war? China or the United States of America?
Let me tell you, I look at this as a negotiation. People look at it as a trade war. I look at it as a negotiation. These are two big economies that have been trading, and each of them have potential advantage. And so what is happening today is the United States doesn't feel it's being treated fairly, claiming that our market is open, and yet...
You see a justification for this renegotiation?
I think the trade war is about fair trade. How can we make the trade between our country fair? How do I balance my trade with the counterpart? So it's a matter of negotiation, in my opinion. With negotiation, you're a threat.
The Middle East, Europe, and Africa accounted for about 70% of your revenues. I mean, considering what's happening globally in terms of economic activity, where is the next opportunity? What are you eyeing in terms of expansion plans? Because you've got a healthy cash flow. You can do probably a bit more this year and next.
Let me tell you, our strength really is in our experience. We know this business so well. And luckily also, we have invested in line with the trade, meaning we have invested a lot in deep water ports, which gave us an advantage. So today, if you tell me where is next, I will say we need to invest more in Africa. Latin America has a growth. So yeah. There are
Can you name us a few countries that are
like that? I would say the Pacific side of Latin America, we believe, has more potential opportunities than the Atlantic side. I believe Southeast Asia, like Indonesia, still there is potential in Indonesia and Malaysia. I believe India, of course, has a growth despite what happened to the rupees and all that. The market is big, the growth is high. And Africa, again, we need to penetrate more in Africa.
How much of a slowdown, if at all, have you seen in emerging markets? We come in here day after day after day, and we've talked for 8-9 months about emerging markets being under pressure. Are you seeing that? And have you been wrong-footed by the currency slides in emerging markets?
Well, the as far as emerging markets, I think the high prices of oil, some of the risks that are in the market, I think is playing in this. Africa, for example, huge potential, is the largest growth in the world today you will see in Africa. Mm-hmm. The problem with that is the infrastructure is bad. If you look at inter-African trade, it's really 18% of their trade. Mm-hmm. Inter-Asian is about 60%, mm-hmm. and inter-Europe is 70%.
Yeah.
Why they cannot trade together? Because the cost of infrastructure. Now, infrastructure needs private-public partnership. The problem with that is, again, governance. And so, Djibouti is another example.
That's a clear example of some of the governance issues. We talk a lot about oil prices as well. It's helped this part of the world. What do you using as an assumption for oil prices over the next year? $80, $85, what's good for you for global trade?
I think if I know that answer, I make a lot of money.
80 to 90?
I have no idea.
You have no idea. Well, okay, let's get one figure out of you in terms of targets. BI run the numbers. You set the target. You got control of Santos, of course, in Brazil. The target there was for 100 million 20-foot containers by 2020. You're at 88 million at the moment.
Yes.
Will you make that target? Is that what the market can benchmark you?
Let me tell you, it depends. We put that target because we have the capacity.
But are you confident you can make that target?
We have the resources to go to 100 if we need. But I don't want to have port empty just because I want a target. I want the actual.